Hello and welcome. Hi Michael, how is it going?
Hello, hello Alex. Good to see you again.
Welcome back. Welcome back.
Yeah, thank
Did
you.
you have a good time?
It was a really great time. So we are just back from Easter vacation with the family, and we went to the ASOS to retrace Alex's steps there. And from our team as well. And yeah, it was really great. And thanks again for the really good guide.
Good. Glad you said it was helpful.
Helped a lot. So we did almost all the things, and except for the two crater lakes, and it was really amazing. So the weather was not as good as in the week when we were there with the team, but it was still good enough. We saw a bunch of sperm whales, dolphins, and did all the good things. But it's also filling up, so more people are there now, and you really see kind of how the density increases and everything gets more.
I guess you know Easter week also is a popular week for because every you know lots of people have vacations, school holidays and everything.
Exactly. So I'm glad that we went and the family liked it as well, and we
good.
took a lot of really great pictures and had a good time. Really nice place where we stayed as well, and so we were in Furnas this time, so close to the hot bath.
And, did you go every day?
No, not every day, but I was like three times in the one that we were in.
Yeah.
And then once in the one with the park and the and the little mansion.
Yeah.
So that was good. And yeah, so the topic for today is kind of fitting for that as well.
Yes, right? True. So, yeah.
Let's see how well this goes.
Yeah.
And let us know where you're watching from. Hello, Halle from Australia.
Hi, Halle. How's it going?
Evening session for you then.
Yeah, I think it's probably very late or somewhat late. Yeah. So it's good.
Yeah.
Yeah. So cool. Thank you everybody for joining. Good morning, good evening, good afternoon, depending on where you are watching this, or if you're watching this any time after we have recorded this. So it's great to have you join us. This is the Discover Neo4j AuraDB session. We do irregularly on a Monday, so we'll see how it usually on a Monday, but not every Monday, and. Yeah. Yeah,
next week we are out for a conference again, right?
So exactly, next week we need to skip. We'll be out, but maybe we see what the time permits.
But what we can do is we can share with people where they can find past sessions. So it's probably a good place to start if you're homesick for our stream, then you can go and watch past episodes.
There is a YouTube playlist. I'll post it in chat, so you can go there and watch all our previous episodes. Hi, Philip from New Zealand. So seems popular today with the Australian what's it called continent. New Zealand is not part of obviously the Australian continent, but the Oceania. Maybe. Welcome, nevertheless. Let's dive in. We do something a little bit different today. I still run the slides, even though they are not 100% accurate, because we changed. We're not gonna do AuraDB free today. Is that right, Michael?
Yeah, exactly. So we had.
We had a short change of plans or a quick...
Exactly, we had a change of plans, but I think it's still very valuable and also relatable to what we just discussed with the vacation and going out.
Exactly. So maybe before we dive in, Graph Connect is coming. It's happening in June. Month and a bit almost, so it's quite
very soon.
So looking forward to it. The first people speaking have been confirmed, so the agenda is building as we speak. So if you're interested in it, if you can make it to Austin, check it out.
We'll be there as well.
Will be
you
there as
can
well.
we can meet in person, and actually we plan to do an live RDB free exploration session, and so
Exactly.
that would be really, really cool.
So we will be there. Then the developer survey is still going, so I think this is the last time
Yeah, I
last
think
few
so.
days where you're able to do fill it in. So if you are wanting to share your thoughts on how you use Neo4j and what you do with it, it'd be nice if you could take a couple of minutes and give us your feedback on it. The link to the survey is here in the on the slides, and I will obviously put it in chat in a second. So this is the general plan. So not something we're gonna do today, but in more or less it still
But very
fits
similar, so
exactly.
it's not so different from what we do today.
In a sense, if you have a data set, if something is interesting for you, but you don't know, or you don't dare to do it yourselves, or you think, oh, this could be cool for the pro for the for this program, please let us know. We are always looking for data sets. We are always interested in trying out new things. So if there is a data set you know of and you think is cool for us, then please share it with us anywhere, really. I mean, Twitter, Discord, email, here in chat, wherever. I mean, it'll find a way to us. In general, what we do, we take the data set, we look at it, we think what questions we could ask, what kind of queries we would need to write for that, and then we determine the data model, map it out a little bit, and then import the data and load and query that data. And then, today, obviously not AuraDB free. So the topic today is going to be airports. Various airports and connections between the airports or flight connections, and we are running this on AuraDS.
Yes, exactly.
DS is the data science branch from AuraDB. So we have a database and the data science edition. Data science edition obviously is meant for data scientists. This was released just 2 weeks ago on the 12th of April, 13th of April. Really recent. If you are a data scientist, or if you're interested in the data scientist space with graphs, then there is this link here on our Neo4j website. I'll post it in chat, so you can check that out. And there's lots of resources and information about how graph data science works, and how you can make use of it in depending on what your use case is. If it's a machine learning scenario, if it's a knowledge graph, if it's some kind of data graph algorithm space where you want to know some things with on community detection, for example, or on some other shortest neighbors or shortest paths and something like this. So there is
Exactly.
a huge library available, and it's very, very powerful. So if this is something you want to dive in, you're interested in, you'd like to use, then check it out. And there was also a blog post
Yeah,
that
exactly.
Alicia wrote 12, so 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Where
And
she
even
wrote.
for transactional applications, right? So if you collect data in a transactional application, then you can use this data and then get other insights from it. So imagine you have an payment processing application that uses a graph database like Neo4j. Then you can take this application where you have transactions or payments between buyers and sellers of some kind. But then you want to find clusters, other clusters of people that interact frequently with each other. So you can basically turn this transactional data into an user-to-user payment graph and then do things like money laundering or cluster detection or follow the money and things like that. So it's basically something that also enables you for transactional applications to take the next step basically in your graph insight journey and get more out of your data, because lots of the value of graphs actually lies between the lines and in the relationships, and oftentimes we don't utilize all of this information and insight as much as we could in transactional applications.
Yeah, and here are the the various algorithms that come with it. So it's quite powerful. Yeah. So
exactly.
I think it's 70 now in total.
It's quite a lot. So there were really, a lot of machine learning and embedding algorithms added and link prediction algorithms. So we started out in DevRel actually in 2017 with the Graph Algorithms Library, which I also have the book here.
Yeah.
Which then in 2019 was turned into the Graph Data Science Library from Neo4j product. So which was the first, and the first release came out last year. And this year we are at version 2 with a lot of additions and capabilities and performance improvements and other things. So it's a really good journey from exploration in developer relations all the way to a robust product library for graph data science.
Yeah.
As such. Cool.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
That's the blog post again here. What's new? But I guess we'll stop talking about it. We start showing you what it does and what it is.
Exactly.
So let me switch over to Michael.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Go. So here's the blog post again.
Yep.
So Alex shared a link about this. And when the blog post came out, our colleague Claire Sullivan published a new sandbox about airport routes. And I wanted to use the sandbox and show it what it looks like in Neo4j sandbox, which is has GDS Graph Data Science version 2 available for free, but also an ORADS so that you can see when you really want to use it in production, then what it would look like there. So you can see the blog post that Alex showed and look through it, just pointing out. And one thing that's also nice that came out is a native Python client where you don't have to write Cypher code manually to call the graph algorithms, but basically you can have a Python API that talks directly to the database and which has a quite nice API as such. So you just connect to the database and then you basically call the algorithms in a Pythonic syntax as such, right? So you don't need to write this in Neo4j browser or Cypher. It's basically plain Cypher, plain Python syntax here as such, which is also nice. Yep. Okay. Cool. So, and as part of this, as I said, Claire created this repository. If you haven't seen our graph example, Neo4j graph examples, GitHub organization yet. So this has all the data sets that we use in Sandbox, but also in Neo4j desktop, and soon also in ORADB free. So you can basically see all of them being used in lots of different places. And everything from Stack Overflow graph to network management to Twitch recommendations, the movie recommendation sandbox, which is also used in Graph Academy, ICIJ data, and so on. And one of them is the airport graph that we just saw, airport routes, which Claire created. Unfortunately, Claire moved on from Neo4j to a new job, but she left us with this. Legacy, to say so, as one of your final things. So thanks, Claire, for creating that.
Thank you, Claire.
And the core of the model is basically airports being connected to each other, and then they are related to continents, countries, and cities, and so on. And this is not such a big graph, but quite dense. So you see, it's 9,000 nodes and 74,000 relationships as such. So it's not so big. And either you can open this in Neo4j Sandbox or in ORADS, and I'll show you both. And basically, if you want to query it, you can just either query between airports, which is more the data science-y aspect, or the geographical aspects. Otherwise, you have dump files, and there's also load script in the browse guide, which we'll look at in a second. Okay, so I'll we'll share this as well in the guide. So I'll just send this to Alex. One second. GitHub commonly for J graph examples, airport routes. So and if you look at it, it has in the file also the routes and nodes as well for loading it, and there's also load scripts and code examples as well. Okay. Looking at this, one thing that I wanted to mention is actually that airport routes is something that's a classical graph database example data sets, right? So if you Google for Neo4j airport routes, there are tons of blog posts and examples and more complex like multi-transfer routes and multi-model and modeling discussions and so on. So we won't go into all the details, but if you're interested in this topic, a lot of people have written very detailed about flight and transport optimizations with Neo4j. So this is a topic which is really, really deep as such. So this is basically just Googling for Neo4j airport routes as such. So there's a ton of content available there. Okay, so in Sandbox, you can just create this sandbox. If you click on new project, and you had, no, not anymore, but there was the Graph Data Science Sandbox, which is then the airport routes. And if I open this with Neo4j browser, it fires up browser and starts the browser guide for this. Shiva, you can just ask the questions here, or you can go to community.neo4j.com or to community.neo4j.com/chat, which gets you to our Discord. But Alex can also share these as
I'll
well.
share this in the link, but also we do a Aura DB Q&A session later today,
Oh
so you
yeah, an
can
AMA, yeah, that's true.
maybe that's the perfect session. I'll share the link in the
That's a
chat
really
tonight.
great point for everyone in general. And so perhaps you should add this to the to your intro slides anyway, when the AMA sessions are as such. So you see the sandbox starts. There's a bunch of data already in here, nodes for airports, for routes as well. So there are lots of routes, of course, between airports, as you can see, right? And especially large airports have a lot of connections, like Chicago or the or Dubai, for instance, have a lot of routes. So this is only showing like a tiny subsection of the airport routes. This sandbox comes already with the data. And then the guide walks us through data model, how to load the data, which we don't need to do anymore, and then what the schema looks like as a schema visualization, which you already see. So on the web page, here's the airport, and then we have continent, region, city, and country. It's probably a little bit dense. I mean, it's a nice star here, but all these transitive things we actually don't need, right? So we would only need basically country is on continent, airport is in city, and city is in region. So this is what we actually would need in the graph model. So these extra relationships are a little bit redundant that we don't need as such. Anyhow, right? So basically, this is what the model actually looks like, right? So we have the airport in a city, in a region, in a country, on a continent. We could even fold them together, say, storing the continent on the country or storing the region on the city or something like that to make it a little bit more compact as such. And then it explores the data a little bit, for instance, looking at how many or what's the largest airports on a certain continent. So it takes, oh no, it shows the number of airports on a continent. So this is the continent, and then this is the number of airports. So North America has almost 1,000 airports, Asia has also as much, Europe 600, and so on, right? And Oceania has 304. That's where our down under friends are watching from. Right. And so it has a little bit more of the exploration and then goes into graph data science. To continue with the graph data science thing on Aura itself, what you can do is, so we can, it doesn't matter where we run the guide actually as such, right? So you can use run it on Sandbox, but I also wanted to show you what ORIDS looks like. So you can here on the top switch between ORIDB and ORIDS. And if I want to create a new instance for ORIDS, I call this, for instance, airports. I have 8,000 nodes, and what was it? 75,000 relationships or something like that.
75, I think, yeah.
And I want to run community detection, centrality, and pathfinding algorithms, and say, calculate, please, how big this instance should be. So we want to use the smallest instance size anyway. And what's really nice about these ORIDS instances, you can just use them, get your data and your insights, and then you can either pause them or delete them again, and then you need a new one. So they're more transient than ORIDB instances. So an ORIDB instance you would keep around for powering your applications, but these ORIDS instances are oftentimes used as compute instances that you create on demand, and then if you have the data that you have, you can get rid of them. So I just copy the password somewhere. Continue. So, and this will take a bit to set it up. And while it's setting this up, we'll continue with the guide in the sandbox as such. So, cool. So if you have questions, feel free to ask questions. For instance, another thing that we can see is we can see the top airports as such. So this would return all airports, but if you want to see, let's say the top 25 airports or something like that, it says, okay, an airport has a route somewhere. This is outbound routes. And it gives me the airport and the number of routes, and then returns. Oh, that's actually the total. So this computes how many routes does an airport have, and then it computes across all the airports what's the maximum number of routes, minimum number of routes, average and standard deviation across all airports. So this is for outbound. maximum outbound routes is 307, which is quite a lot. And I'm not sure actually if we take inbound and outbound routes, what it looks like then, and double it. So we have in this data set, it stores both inbound and outbound ones. Because it seems that some airports only have outbound ones to others and not inbound ones. But what we can do is we can, instead of counting routes, we can count how many distinct other airports is an airport connected to. That's probably the most accurate number as such. So that's 308, so it's one more than the 307 that we saw. So there's one airport that has an... Or on the largest airport, there's an one connection that just is inbound and not outbound. Mm-hmm. And you also see that the standard deviation is also really high. So that's probably a power law distribution as well. So what you could also do is return the percentiles, discrete number 99. Let's see how this distributes the 90th, 75, and 50th percentile. So you see that even on the 99th percentile, it's only 185 outbound or connections, right? And then it tapers off pretty quick. So the 50th mm-hmm. percentile is three only. That's probably like very tiny airports, like on the ASOs where they landed on the crater seas, crater lakes, basically.
Yeah.
And then, so these are hub and spoke things, right? So where the spokes are really just an airport that has one or two connections to a large airport, and that's it. right? So you always have to fly first to the hub and then you
Yeah.
can continue somewhere else. And then even 75th percentile have only 11 connections, right? So that's not a lot as such. And then here you see that it kind of is really like a power law distribution, right? So it grows really, it triples almost from 95 to 99th percentile as
Yeah,
such.
that also shows us that there isn't too many airports that have a really a huge number of
Exactly, right.
connections.
Exactly, that's kind of the power law thing.
Yeah.
Exactly. Okay, and going back to our guide, what else do we have? Oh, that's the distance, which is also interesting. It looks at what are the distances between airports and looks at the statistics of those again. So let's see, what's the minimum distance is probably 2 kilometers, 13 kilometers, I think. And the maximum distance is 10,000, right? So that's probably
Can
some.
we see how, what these are? 2 kilometers apart.
Yeah, I think. Let's see. What you can do is where r dot distance equals 2 turn r, and then we can also see what the max is. So, oh, AB. So that is Papa Westray and Westray. So there's an airport in, where is this?
We see.
It's in the EU, in Great Britain somewhere. What country is this, UK?
Scotland.
Somewhere in
Upper
Scotland.
Westray Airport is in Scotland. Yeah.
Okay.
It's in Orkney.
Interesting.
Ah, this is the shortest flight. It's known that this is the shortest charter flight on Earth because the distance is 2.8 kilometers.
Is it
It's
like an
just from
island
it's
to
from one
mainland?
island to the other.
Ah, okay. So it's similar to the ASOS, I guess, right? So I
It's
don't
similar,
know.
but even closer.
I don't know how much Pico was from. It's like 80 kilometers or something like that, right?
So
We can actually look at A dot. Is it code or what is it? IATA, the SOA
That's
airport.
what it officially is, but I don't know how they. IATA, yes. IATA.
So you see that actually the ASOS is well connected to a lot of other airports, right? So that's
Mainly
260 connections.
Although lots of, I mean, they have nine islands and every island is connected by air,
Yeah,
so that's probably the
Pico,
main.
Flores,
Exactly.
and you could say and r dot distance is less than 200 kilometers perhaps. That should be the islands, right?
Yeah.
So
Maybe.
each of the islands is also connected with each other.
Yeah.
Cool. Super. Okay. So let's see if our meanwhile our ORDS instance is running here. So it's running now. And we can now go to query, which is near for the browser. So just getting the password back. And so this database is now empty. There's nothing in there. But what we can do is we can say play sandbox airport routes index.html, which is basically the same play command that the browser guide ran in sandbox. So you see that it looks the same. And then we see a little bit of explanation. And here is the load script, so which we can now load. So it creates a bunch of constraints. This was quick. And then it loads the data from the nodes. So it should be also quite quick. So we now have our airports and city, country, and so on, which we could clean up a little bit if you wanted to. But what's more interesting is loading the routes here. So it's basically source airport with IATA to target airport and setting the distance as an integer value here. Or perhaps we should probably show for creating the airports and regions, it basically creates the nodes here and then connects them as such, right? So, and as I said, we don't need all these relationships, so we could also save some of those and then just set it as properties instead. So for instance, we could set region on city as a property, or we could set a continent as a property on country as well.
Yeah, it always
Right.
depends, right? I mean, what kind of queries you
What do
run,
you want to
what you
vary
want to, yeah.
exactly? Yeah, exactly. So, and then it sets a bunch of properties here on these, which is actually also so setting city on the city is not really needed because that's already there. What's interesting, we also have the geo information on the airport, so we can also do geo distances basically between them, which could be interesting to see how much is the route between two airports different from the geo distance, actually distance. And so what's the how the bird flies basically distance to the airport route distance. So because sometimes they fly not exactly a direct line, but some other line. Okay, so we imported already the airport, city, region, country, and continent. And it also has altitude, which is nice. And this is the number of runways and the longest runway as well. So you can also see which airports have the most runways as well. So we can also say what are the return airport order by A dot runways descending limit
I think
10.
it did. Oh, it did. Okay.
So, or we can probably return the A dot description and A dot IATA and the runways and A dot longest. So there are a bunch of airports in the US which have seven, and then Amsterdam and six, and then Amsterdam is the only one in Europe that has as
Yeah.
many. And then the long ones you need for the large flights, I think, because they need more runway to lift off, right?
Big.
But this is kind of additional information that you can also use for route planning and other things as well, right?
Yeah, I mean, depends, right? Like I said, if you're flying an A380 airplane that has a requirement of a runway this long, then you know, okay, in this airport it cannot land because it's not long enough.
Exactly. And before you
Although I think
get go
the
and graph the rest,
A380 has not
yeah.
a huge requirement for long runways, but you know what I mean.
Yeah, exactly. So, and now we can load the routes themselves, which, as I said, is basically just this CSV file, and it finds the source airport and target airports by IATA code, sets the creates the relationship, and sets the distance. And obviously, because we saw this before, there are two entries oftentimes for two airports, so one from A to B, the other one from B to A. Such, so now just loads 50,000 or so 46,000 relationships, and now these route relationships have the distance as well. So we can actually ch change this to distance, so it shows not has route but distance on the relationship. So we see actually how far they are apart from each other as well, and, which is quite nice. Which reminds me, should look at this in Bloom as well to see we could kind of color them or style them by distance and perhaps also the airports by number of by the degree as well.
And then you see.
So that's actually what something we could do already is basically we just go to the airports and A, B. With distinct, with count distinct B as a degree. So, and we just take inbound and outbound, and then we just set a dot degree as a degree. So this is something that we can do directly also without GraphDL signs, because it's just a degree count, which is super, super quick. Mm-hmm. And now we could already style them in Bloom with distance and degree. Perhaps we should do this before we dive into GraphDL signs.
Yep.
So let me just copy my password again. And if we go to our Aura DS, we can click on explore, put in Neo4j and a password, and then it creates a style for us. We have airports here, so we can see airport to airport route. And it fetches, I think, 1,000 routes now. And while it's doing this, which should actually be a bit faster, we can actually style at rule based. Oh, that's a lot.
I think your limit was more than 1,000.
Oh, it could be. It could be that it was 10,000 actually, because I played around with Bloom earlier. And so it's actually 10,000. So that's a little bit more.
Yeah.
So perhaps you can clear this and can reduce the limit a little bit. So. Okay, airport. Okay. So, I mean, it just looks a little bit more boring, right? So, I wonder. Okay, let's show the styling first. So what you can do is we can say we want to color, we want to size the airports by this.
Yep.
And if you apply size, so we say from.
I need to think you need to do range.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, you're right. So now we can say apply size, and the smallest one is 0.25, and the largest one are 4x. Basically, right? So you see already the big bubbles are the larger airports as such. And then we can do the same for relationship for the has route. We can use the distance and range again. And we could color them by a range, or we could make them bigger by range, right? So we can say, okay, the large ones are really, really fat, and the other ones are really thin. And we see also kind of the long distance relationships are now really, so you see immediately what which ones are the international flights between large airports, for instance, right? So that's something that we can see. We could even apply a filter here and say, give me airports where the degree is greater than, let's see, so we can actually use the histogram here. Let's say 100 or so, right? So that should have at least 100. And so it grays them out, but we can also just dismiss them. And now we should only have like the big airports left here in our filter. And you see, these are the big airports, and they have a lot of these fat relationships as well, which are the long distance flights as well, right? So that's something, and if you zoom in, then you see as well, should probably color them by IADA code. Label them by IADA code. I'm not sure why it's not showing.
Yeah, maybe city is also fine.
Yeah.
Or description.
Yeah, you can probably set them. All right, we should probably pick city. Yeah, it's not showing. Something is. I think we had this before that it's not showing when we updated.
Yeah, we had. Yeah.
Anyway, so that's kind of something where you can visually see things like degrees and other things. So we can probably go back and look at clusters later in Bloom, but that's the first thing that we can see. Anyway, so much for data exploration and data loading. What we can do now is basically look at the graph data science aspects. So remember, this is still running in RDS, so that's why the graph data science library is available. So for instance, if I run return gds.version, it should give me a current version of graph data science. As well, if I run the same in ORDB, it won't return anything. But in Sandbox, it's also available. Okay, so what you can do is you can take this kind of let's say this is a transactional data that kind of manages airport routes, and someone has like management software that manages these airport routes. But when we want to compute graph algorithms, you would project this into an in-memory graph, and that uses this graph project thing. And the most important thing is we have to give it a name and say which nodes and which relationships do we want to take for that. And the simplest one is basically we have a projection that we call just routes, takes the airport node and the has route relationship, right? So we have done an in-memory graph which has airports and routes only. So basically what we saw in Bloom as such.
Yeah.
So if you run this, it should be really quick, and it creates an in-memory graph with 3,500 nodes and 46,000 relationships, which is our airports and their relationships, which you also saw when we imported data as well. And what it uses, natural orientation means that it uses the direction that we had in the graph. You could also say reverse or undirected, then it would treat them as undirected as such. Currently, there's no property on the relationship here. So we'll do this a little bit later for the distance as well. So what we can do now is we can look at these kind of in-memory graphs and say, okay, which ones do we have? So we see that we have only one, which is called routes, and we can list this particular one if you want to see more information about it. But now for running actually the algorithms, they have different execution modes. You can either stream your results back, you can write to Neo4j, or you can write to the in-memory graph, which is called mutate, and stats is just running the algorithm and gives you statistical information, for instance, degree distribution and things like that. So this kind of general syntax, which is not so interesting, but what gets interesting is something like PageRank, right? So how can we determine not just the direct degree, what's kind of how many relationships does an airport have, but also indirect ones. So, and how do the two differ as well, right? So the page rank also increases the rank of a node indirectly. So if multiple nodes point to this node through other nodes, then their page rank is also bigger. So not just the number of first degree inbound relationships, but also second degree or third degree. So it flows basically across their neighbors to the node as such. So like website ranking, that's where it came from a layout page, basically from Google. And so we can compute the degree as we've done before. Here that this kind of regular centrality, so we've talked about this already before. And so Frankfurt actually has the highest degree for inbound and outbound. It's actually interesting that the European ones have more routes than the Americans. And it's probably because they have the inner European and then the international routes as well.
Probably more the continent in with the various countries. It's shorter distances, but more destinations.
Exactly. This is just if I want to create the same in-memory graph twice and such. Okay, so what's interesting is if you want to run PageRank, we can just say, please run PageRank on this in-memory graph and then return me the node ID and score, and then we get basically the node back and we can then get access information from this node. So I'll change this a little bit because I think it's better to say with snode as airport and score. So we have our airport and our score, and then we can just return airport.aida, airport.description. And you also, if you remember, we also, did we store this here actually? No, that was in the sandbox, right? That we stored the degree.
I think that was in the sandbox.
Do we still have this here somewhere?
Yeah.
Where we set the degree?
Or maybe it was in.
Or was it in OLS?
No, oh, well, we just didn't. No, in Bloom we just. Right. So it must have been. Because we did look at it in Bloom.
Exactly. Must have been, right? So here we have. Yeah, here's degree. Okay, cool. Because I want to also return the degree so that we compare can compare it with the PageRank score as well. Hmm. So, and then it runs, and now we see which airports have the highest PageRank score. And you see that they are also correlating to the first level degree, right? So the degree is kind of just the one hop
yep.
connections, and the PageRank actually is also second and third degree, what they add to it. But they're still correlating, right? So you see that the highest, highest PageRanks also have high first level degree, and then a bit more is added by the indirect connections. And here, actually, it's interesting that the American ones have higher degree because their connecting airports have also a higher degree. So they basically participate in the importance of their other airports. And also, they have probably more mid-size airports connecting to them as well.
Yeah. Yeah.
But that's kind of a general way of how you would stream results back. So this is not modifying anything in Neo4j. That just returns the results back. And if I wanted to, for instance, I could say, export this as JSON, or I could use this from Python and say, please render this as an histogram or something like that, right? Or mm-hmm. however, mm-hmm. or put it on a map. Or and because you also have the point information, so we also have this.
So yeah, so you don't change your original data, you just...
Exactly, this is just purely in-memory projection and then compute and stream back the results, yeah. right? So this doesn't change anything. So if we were to change this to mutate, I don't know if... yeah,
I
exactly.
Think, yeah.
So if you want to write this back somehow, so for instance, write writes it back to Neo4j itself. So it's basically the same call. But instead of stream, it says here write, and then we say what property do we want to write it back as, and then if we run this, it should be also really quick. So it adds 3,000 properties, and now each of our airports has also a PageRank attribute, this one here. Right. So now in Bloom, if you refresh the perspective, you could choose to also size nodes based on a PageRank and not on the degree.
For instance. Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The other thing that we can do is we could write it back to the memory graph, and I think it's the same attribute for write property, and it doesn't let us because it's called mutate property, not write property. Okay, mutate property PageRank. So now we have in the in-memory graph an additional property on the node, which is called PageRank. So for instance, if we now want to run another graph algorithm or a machine learning algorithm that kind of includes PageRank as one of the attributes for importance or similarity, right? So for instance, you could say airports with a similar PageRank range are kind of similar, right? So the large ones have a similar PageRank and the small ones also have a similar PageRank. So it kind of represents a different kind of similarity, not kind of on which continent they are or other information, but kind of more about their structural similarity in a way, right? So are they large or small airports? Do they have a lot of connections or not? Right. So that's something that I can then use in the in-memory graph as well.
So with this, I can basically continue working with my in-memory graph without having to write the data into my graph if I don't wanna like a mid-step sort of while
exactly.
I'm
it's, calculating. If it's only a temporary result that I don't really need to store as such, but I just want to continue to use in my computation. So imagine you have like a compute pipeline, machine learning compute pipeline, and as the first initial steps, you compute a bunch of graph algorithm properties like clustering or centralities like PageRank and so on. And those would be added to the regular attributes that come from other sources. But then you have these kind of graph or topological attributes features that you could also use to train your machine learning model as well.
Okay.
Right. Okay. So we wrote it back both now to the in-memory graph and to the Neo4j graph. So if you now return data from the Neo4j graph, you see PageRank. And if we do call GDS graph list, and if you put in routes or not, it doesn't really matter because you only have one. Now we also see that node projection should have an additional property, does it? Oh, no, that's just the configuration when we created
it. I think
it
was at the very beginning already.
Here, on this, it says now PageRank is a float value. Yep. That's additional. By the way, this graph list also gives us a degree distribution already out of the box, which is quite nice. So we see already how is the visitor. She wants to be on screen.
Apparently, yes. Nice.
I guess she also wants to travel by plane sometime. Yeah. Not so easy. Okay. No. The next one is it's kind of a comfort animal. You know.
Yeah, exactly. You just need to make sure that you know you declare it as such.
Okay. Yeah, she always wants to climb up my leg and then. Okay, the next thing that we can do with graph algorithms is clustering algorithms, which basically identifies are there groups of nodes that are more tightly connected to them each other than to the rest of the graph. That kind of forms a cluster. And there are different clustering mechanisms clustering algorithms. And one that's quite good in terms of quality is Louvain. So it's a good mix of quality and runtime. So there are much better ones in terms of output, but they run longer for graphs. But this is a really small graph, so it runs in a few milliseconds anyway. And Louvain modularity is basically...
And people can, I mean, there are docs, right? I mean, I think
exactly, you already linked to the docs.
I can put it in again. And then you can see what the differences are and what
exactly
what
there are also does what. Exactly, there are also developer pages. So if you go to why doesn't it not open? I think at the end Claire might have developer documentation, GDS documentation at the end of the guide, and she has also in video series as well. So if you go here, then you see also Claire's video series where she goes into more detail for these. As well. And here's the documentation, which Alex already showed at the beginning.
Yeah,
as well.
Just link to that.
And in developer guides, there's also graph data science here. And so we have more kind of human-friendly explanations of all the different algorithms and why to use them and how to use them and so on. Right? Exactly. So. Okay, back to Louvain. I think Louvain was somewhere here. So our Louvain basically looks exactly the same as we had for PageRank. So we do GDS Louvain stream on our routes graph. Instead of in score, we get community ID back. And then each community is basically a group of airports. And what we do is basically we can convert this into a just count star as number as airports, and then we collect the cities that are in the in this group as well, right? So, and if it runs, so it streams our results back again, and so it doesn't change anything in the graph. So we see our first cluster has 670 entries. So these are look all like the US ones, right? Then the second one is the European cluster, which has the UK and Germany and Brussels and Scandinavia and so on. And the next one is the India. And interestingly, it connected also
Yeah,
South
to South and
Africa
South
and
Africa, yeah.
Africa to
And
it
the
and
Arabic Peninsula.
Arab countries.
Yeah.
Interesting. Probably because of distance between them as well.
And maybe because
Then we
of
have
connection problem, yeah.
Tokyo, Malaysia,
Yeah.
and
Asian, yeah.
the Asian countries. Then we have our down under friends between New Zealand and Australia as well. And then South America with Brazil. And then this last cluster is probably looks like is this like Canada or so, or I don't know. Interesting.
Could be
Would
some
need to
ocean,
check.
Indian Ocean
Yeah,
or
and
Pacific.
this looks like Nordic as well,
This
perhaps
Nordic,
Greenland
yes.
or Iceland, so.
Yeah, and Iceland, exactly. Yeah.
Still a
The
lot of
interesting thing
people.
about this now is that we
And
do
they get much
have,
smaller, right? So
yeah.
the large ones have really a lot of airports, and the
Smaller
small
group.
ones are really like these small groups of islands or small groups of places that are connected as such. Yeah,
And
also the Orkney, so in Scotland, they have their own little cluster as such.
Orkney,
So they're more tightly connected between each other than with the rest of the world, right? So that's kind of really interesting.
well, it
And
kind of
Poland
makes sense.
is connected itself for whatever reason. So that's probably like a data quality issue. Or that's because of, so there are actually multiple airports in Berlin,
Maybe
four
that's
of
the
them,
old one
right? So
that has
that's
been
why.
switched off.
Yeah, so what we could do instead of connecting, getting the city here is the AIDA code. And then. Oh no, actually, it's
Tegel,
interesting.
yeah, but Tegel is
Tegel,
no
Schönefeld
longer.
are different ones.
Yeah, but they are no
I don't
longer.
know. It's probably some data problem there as
No,
such.
I
So
think
there
they
seem to
probably
be a
still.
bunch of things that are not.
They might still be in, but they are no longer in operation. They have both been, you
Or
know.
it could be that these are orphaned ones
Yes.
that don't have any. Oh, that's actually a good question for our data set. So if we find has route access. Yeah, you're right. These are the ones that are kind of orphan nodes that don't have any. So it's probably discontinued airports, which are quite a lot.
A lot, yeah.
Interesting. 211 of our 3,000 airports are not connected to anything else. And these are all clusters of one, basically. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, could be some other
That's
reason.
why
Could
also the
be.
cluster size was here one from here on, right? So that's
Yeah.
kind of only one airport in those. Interesting.
Interesting on this list. If you scroll up a little bit more, is then we had obviously defined a country and a continent and a region in our data set, but in for this query we didn't touch this. We just looked at the
Exactly.
airport, we looked at where they're connected, and without this other information, it basically made the continent by
Yeah.
itself. So
Yeah. Or
North
like
America, Europe,
exactly this kind
sort
of
of like regions, not exactly
logical
maybe,
group of,
but logic,
yeah,
yes. Yeah.
exactly. Really cool. And that's what I really love about these graph algorithms. We had the same with like with Game of Thrones data as well, that you could actually make sense of like who are the main characters and when do they have what interactions and how important are they just by looking at their interactions and running graph algorithms on them,
Yes.
right? So without actually reading the books. So there's so much data hidden in these connections. It's really always so so impressive to me and so
Yeah.
a little bit surprising as well
It is
how
amazing,
well
yeah.
this algorithm can just take the contextual information of what we have in the graph and turn it into something that we know is there and we know exists as a high level construct somehow, right? But it's not obvious just looking at the data for us humans at least, right? So which
Yeah.
is
That's why
just
it's so
really interesting.
powerful. I mean, it's tell me who you connected with and I tell you who you are, kind of
Exactly. It's
in a social
basically like,
network.
tell
Yeah.
me who your friends are, right? So tell me what you
Exactly.
read,
Yeah.
and I tell you what you are or who you are, right? So it's like all these old. We should probably find some of these old sayings and see how many of
Yeah.
those apply to graphs. Should probably do an sayings analysis version of Discover ordinary free, kind of
Yeah.
input some sayings data and then look at what's in there. Okay, so this is kind of the communities. And what we could do now is basically we could write them back to the graph and then use, instead of stream here, we can use GDS Louvain write. Oops, what is this? Write. And then it is write property is Louvain or community. And can run this. And now in Bloom, we can actually refresh the perspective here. Refresh. And now our airport should also have community here. And now we can color them by, so you can add another one. Community. Range, color, and then we can color them across the spectrum. Actually, we can use unique values, which then assigns a different color to each of these communities as such.
Yes. Yeah.
And then apply color, and you see now that all these airports have different colors, right? So the European ones are purple, the blue ones are
Asian,
Asian,
I think.
This one is SVO, PKO, I don't know, DME. The yellow ones are US, North
American,
America. Yeah. Sydney is down under. So if we also expand, for instance, one of those, has route. So these have been filtered because we have our filter still here. So you can probably not apply a filter. So you see that, oops. So you see that like all the red ones are now the Asia Pacific, sorry, the ANZ
Australian,
ones in
Oceania.
Australian, right? And then you could connect them also to their country or continent, and you would see they would have the same continent basically. So if I expand here to in on continent, I probably need to get rid of the other ones. Did it select them? Doesn't like me. It seems when I get out of the window frame that it kind of stops my selection thing. So if I say dismiss selected, and now they got other colors. That's also weird. It should be stable.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think you found two things that we need to report back to our in country. But where's the country now? I can't see the country. It's our country.
Country is blue.
Yeah, it's not so helpful that it's blue, right?
And continent is
Australia, yeah. But I still can't. Ah, there is Australia. So I just wanted to show basically that exactly that all these other ones are in the same cluster basically, right? So they're all in the oh no, I didn't want to do the city. Oh, let me just dismiss the cities. I wanted to show that basically these airports that share a country are in the same cluster as well, right? So they are on the same continent, and that's one of the reasons why they are more tightly connected to each other as well. Okay, and then the browser guide continues with node similarity, which basically says, okay, we take a bunch of attributes of our airports and see how similar are they as such, right? So, and then here in this data set, you could say, okay, they are similar. What do they have here? It computes node similarity by neighborhood and top K. It's not really clear to me what attributes. So, because there are no attributes, it would just be similar by neighborhood. So, who are the like closest from that perspective? So that doesn't make so much sense. I would probably add a bunch of other attributes for similarity that I would compare, like number of runways, geolocation, and other things as well.
Yeah, destinations maybe.
Yeah, exactly. So, but at least it explains the thing. And then the interesting thing is pathfinding, basically, where we could create a new graph, in-memory graph, which also contains the distance on relationships here, and has a new name called routes weighted. And then on this in-memory graph, we can now say compute shortest path on the in-memory graph as well. But this can also compute all shortest paths or all weighted shortest paths or like more complex path finding as well. So I'm not sure why it's complaining. Cartesian product. Yeah. Okay. So if I run this, it finds Denver and
Malé, that's Malediven.
Malé. And then it shows us that the shortest path here between these has a distance of 9,700 kilometers between Denver and MLA. And then these would be the nodes. And this is kind of the distance between them as such, I think.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I need to change a couple of times. It's basically on the other side of the globe.
Yeah, exactly.
No.
So it goes once around. And so you can basically put in target sources and then say, I want you to use the distance property on this. But there are lots of other pathfinding algorithms which can then compute all the shortest paths from one airport to all the other ones, for instance, in one go, which is something that you would do on your in-memory graph, right? So something like this, you could also do in Neo4j with APOC itself, with Dijkstra. But when you want to do more complex or on the fly computations, then you can do this. And another thing is this in-memory graph stays around in memory, so you basically can continue to use it also from a real application, basically by just calling this, and then you get this stuff back, and it computes in a few milliseconds or something like that. So you can do more complex route calculations as well. Okay, and then a little bit about docs and cleaning up at the end. So we can clean up our in-memory graphs here with drop, and then
Clean
we're
up
good to
means
go.
basically they are
Remove from memory,
removed from
exactly.
memory. Yeah.
Exactly. And then here, as I said, showed before, there's the GDS documentation and other places where you can use this, and the video series
Yeah, the
as
video
well.
series is really good as well. Gives a great overview of all
Yeah.
kinds of algorithms and various other things. I'll put a link to that in description,
Yeah,
so you
exactly.
can have a look
Yeah.
at that.
So I'll just send it to you, Alex, so you have it.
Cool, thank you.
Second. So cool, and that's about it. So, and this is our ORRDS instance, and because now we are kind of done with it, we can in Aura DS, we can basically delete it, and then, or we could actually pause it. So there's also the pause button, which then only incurs a fraction of the costs. And I'm not sure. We can also resize it, but it's already the smallest size. And we can also clone to an AuraDB instance. So if I want to continue to use this in an AuraDB instance, or clone to an existing instance as well.
Ah, okay. So you could do your calculations, your computations on graph algorithms on AuraDS, and then say, okay, now I'm done. This has been created now with new information. I want to push it back over to my AuraDB space and continue working there as a
As a transactional information.
Okay, cool.
And you can also download snapshots, which are then dump files that you can continue to use somewhere else as well, if you want to, before you clean out your database. But for us, we can remove it and then we're good here.
Perfect. Okay.
Super.
Super cool. That was very interesting
from my side.
And a good overview. Thank you very much, Michael. As I said, if you are interested in Aura DB or DS, either way, we are running a Q&A session later today with David Allen. So if you have any questions, if anything is interesting to you about this, or if you just want to listen in what other people ask, join us. Put the YouTube link in chat. It starts at 5 p.m. CET, so basically in a couple of hours. You can set a reminder in YouTube if you're interested. Other than that, tomorrow I'm having an interesting Neo4j live session on a FIFA 22 dataset. So we'll explore the football or soccer players that are in the video game FIFA 22. And we explore together with Ifeani what players they are, what position they play in, what teams they are playing for, and where they're coming from, and all this data that there is. And we explore this in Neo4j. So that's happening tomorrow at 5 p.m. CET. That could be
cool.
Should be fun and cool. I'm looking forward to that.
Super.
And next week we will be not able to do this session, but there will be other sessions going on over the days. So looking forward to seeing you at one of the other live streams. Let us know if you enjoy this. Hit the like and subscribe buttons, obviously, if you want to see more. Give us a shout out on any social media where this where you think this is interesting, or where you think we could be, benefit from anything in terms of, there's a data set, anything else, like we said in the beginning, open for that. And thank you for watching. Thank you for taking part today.
And if you can make it to Stockholm next week for JFocus, or if you're there anyway, then feel free to drop by and say hi in person.
Exactly.
As well.
Yeah. Meet us on the conference.
Cool. Thank you so much, Alex.
Thank you, Michael. Everybody, take care and stay safe. Bye-bye.